I'm so happy to have you all with us here today. I'm Olivia Mattis, representing the Sousa Mendes Foundation, and this is our final Sunday program of 2023. We've been doing these programs for 3.5 years, since the very beginning of COVID, and today is probably our most important program. We have programs on so many subjects to do with rescue, resistance, and hope. And today we're shining a spotlight on this remarkable couple, Serge and Beate Klarsfeld, who are joining us today from Paris. You've seen a beautiful movie about them called Klarsfeld, A Love Story. And maybe it was surprising to you that that was the subject of the film. But in fact, without their love for one another, as they say in the film, they could not have done the very dangerous, courageous, risky work that they have both individually and collectively done for so many years. So today we have a moderator. His name is Peter Hellman. He's a very important author. In the 1970s, he published one of the very first books on rescuers of the Holocaust. It was called Avenue of the Righteous. And I read that book when I was in high school in the 1970s, and it was probably one of the very first books I read about the Holocaust. So I've known about Peter for all these years. And here he is as our guest. So Peter and the Klarsfelds have known each other many years. They've traveled together. They've worked together. They've been arrested together and served time in jail together. So that is quite a bond. Please feel free during the course of the hour to put your questions into the chat box. I will be moderating the audience Q&A portion of the program. But for right now, Peter, please, the floor is yours.
The key date in the relationship between Serge and Beate is May 1960. It occurs on a metro platform, Place de Saint-Cloud in Paris. Beate is waiting on the platform to go to a French lesson at the Alliance Française. Serge is on his way to an event connected to law school. He sees a very handsome young woman. He asks, "Are you English?" He knew she wasn't English, but he figured if she said no, he would hear that she was, in fact, German. By the time Serge left the metro station, he had in his pocket the telephone number of Beate, who was working as an au pair in Paris. And that's the key date, because all that followed in the years and decades after were all the result of this meeting on the metro platform. And more than that, nothing could have happened in the way it did and with the meaning that it did without Beate and Serge and their very different backgrounds. Serge is the son, as you probably know, of a father who was murdered at Auschwitz. His mother, Beate is the daughter of a Wehrmacht soldier, who I hasten to say was not in the SS or any of the bad things. He was just a simple soldier. So, you know, if you went on a dating platform and you said, here's a young guy and his father was killed at Auschwitz, and here's a young woman and her mother, her father was in the Wehrmacht, you would say, this is not gonna work. Not a good relationship here. But in fact, it's been an extraordinary relationship. I just tell me to stop when I need to. From that spring day in 1960, 3 years later, the Klarsfelds got married in Paris. A few years later, 1965, Arno was born. And 7 years later, 8 years later, a daughter, Lida, was born. And I met the Klarsfelds in September 1979 in Paris at their office. The first thing I saw in their office was a magnificent Cocker Spaniel named Petya. That was their dog who was reclining on the floor. And there was a lot of action going on in the office. And as Americans will do, I said, Serge, Beato, what are you doing? What are you working on? And they said, oh, we're about to bring to trial the three top Nazis who had been active in Paris during the occupation. And I remember thinking, what? What do you mean you are bringing to trial the three top Nazis who had been active in Paris? You have no police powers. You have no governmental powers. You're just private citizens. And yet it was true. Yet it was true. Very shortly after, that was September 1979, a month later in Cologne, there was the opening of the trial of the three top Nazis. The Klarsfelds have used the term desk killers. They weren't people who put their hands literally on Jews or pushed them into the boxcars, but they were doing the paperwork which allowed the trains to move to the east to Auschwitz. The Klarsfelds have had two missions in their careers. One is what they call militants de mémoire, militants of memoir, of memory. And that was their efforts to not forget and to bring back the names of the victims of the Shoah as it occurred in France. And I would say that was the most important thing in their minds. Thing two was to bring to justice the top Nazis who were active in France. Three were put on trial in Cologne, as I just mentioned. And they sought out Nazis who were hiding in South America, in Syria, in Chile. So there were these two sides to their activities. One, to restore the memory of the murdered Jews, almost all at Auschwitz, and number two, to bring to trial their as yet unpunished criminals who hunted them down. So these were the two areas of the Klarsfelds. There is here a little plaque that the French wear, and it says, Les fils et filles des deportés de France, the sons and daughters of the Jewish deportees from France. And these are militants of memory. And I proudly wear one on my lapel when I can. And so these are the two areas. And we'll talk more about it in the interview.
Okay, so right now we're going to just see a little video of the Klarsfelds throughout the years.
Quand on a que l'amour pour habiller matin, pauvres et malandrins de manteaux de velours, quand on a que l'amour à offrir en prière pour les maux de la terre en simple troubadour, quand on a que l'amour à offrir à ceux-là dont l'unique combat est de chercher le jour, quand on a que l'amour pour tracer un chemin et forcer le destin à chaque carrefour, quand on a que l'amour pour parler au canon et rien qu'une chanson pour convaincre un tambour, alors sans avoir rien que la force d'aimer, nous aurons dans nos mains, amis, le monde entier.
And here they are, the Klarsfelds themselves. So Peter, take it away.
I first met them, as I said, in Paris in September 1979. And when I asked that question, what are you up to? They said, we're bringing to trial the three top Nazis active in France. And indeed that happened in the next month in Cologne, was convened the trial of three Nazi desk killers, Lischka, Heinrichsen, and Hagen. All had been fairly young. Lischka, I believe, was the oldest, and they all took part in the paperwork that was necessary to get the trains going to the east. Something extraordinary happened. I did go to that trial. In the streets of Cologne, you saw hundreds of Jews, mostly young Jews, and they were holding up banners and signs saying, you know, do justice on behalf of the French Jews, do justice on behalf of Germany, and convict these three criminals. And they were convicted. The trial was a model. I'm going to hold up a book. It's the first of the Klarsfeld's major books. I hope you can see it. Can you all see it? It's called The Memorial to the Jews Deported from France, 1942 to 44. And in it, I'll just turn to any page, you'll see what looks like a telephone book, a New York telephone book. In fact, these are the names, last name, first name, date of birth, place of birth, nationality, if any, of Jews who were deported from France. In all, there are 76,000 names here. And Serge and Beate, the amazing thing to me about this book, and by the way, this is the American edition. The French edition had already been published. I remember thinking, well, there are many narratives about the Holocaust, about the French Holocaust, but just to see these names, last name, first name, date of birth, place of birth, somehow was more powerful than all the narrations, the historical narrations of the Holocaust. And so now I ask a question, finally. Could you tell the audience, Serge and Beate, how were these names assembled? Where did you find the names of all these Jews who were deported?
We couldn't go to the trial of the Nazi criminals who organized the final solution in France without having the Accusation Act. And the Accusation Act was the memorial of the Jews deported from France. So before our action, there was no listing of all these deportees. And I believed that it was impossible to go to a trial without the listing of the victims in order to have the accusation and the defense having that volume on that book on their table, and all the victims of the deportation of Jews from France, 75,000, being present in the trial and not absent of the trial. So we could identify each victim, each deportee, by his name, by his first name, by his date of birth, and by his place of birth. And of course, it was the most important document which was shown during that trial. We show many, many documents signed by the criminals, But that one was the most important. And the 75,000 victims were in the tribunal together with us.
And can I ask, how did you locate the lists of names? Where did you find the lists of names? Where did you find them?
I worked with documents, but documents were not only in France. We found many documents in France. We obtained the access to the documents which were closed until our action, and I found the documents in Israel, in the United States, in Belgium, in Germany, in Poland, and I could establish that memorial with the help of my generation of sons and daughters of deportees from France, with a small group of friends who lost their parents. We gave to each person a listing of one convoy, and they had to type to write the name on a card, the name, the first name, the date of birth, the place of birth of each deportee. And then we found a Jewish school which could type the listing, and we succeeded to print, also to find a printer for the book, because we had no money and it was very difficult. And eventually the book was printed in French, and then thanks to friends like Peter and Elizabeth Hellman, we could print it also in United States. And that was the first book. And Yad Vashem in Jerusalem consider us as pioneers in that field, because today they have close to 5 million names of Jewish victims.
I would like to add something, because, you know, the names were not known in France, you know. Not Jewish organization wanted to print this book, you know. So we did it, and there was a day for Israel, and we put this book for the first time and all the names on the big wall. And you cannot imagine how many survivors, or the children of the dead, but crying. They saw the name for the first time of the families, you know. It was something impossible, because it was an event, you know, and we sold a lot of books, even, because they wanted to have this book in their hands to know what happened to their family, you know.
I'm glad you said that.
And it's not, I would add just that it's not only to make a listing, but also to write the history of each convoy and how it was constituted, with Jews coming from which area, from France. And that was the start also of the history of the final solution in France, which I wrote in 1983, Vichy, Auschwitz, which is the reference book of the final solution in France, in two volumes, yes.
And you see here a French gendarme, I believe, with a German officer together, working together.
Yes, because most of the Jews from France were arrested by the French police due to the collaboration of the Vichy state I could open archives, find documents, and write chronologically the history of the final solution in France.
I will say that for me, not being a scholar, just being a follower, the most remarkable book among many remarkable books that Serge and Beata have brought forward, and they're mostly under the heading Beata Klarsfeld Foundation, which is established here in New York. But the book that is beyond all the others is Le Calendrier. This is a seemingly small book, but I see it has almost 1,300 pages. As small as it is, I think they call this Bible paper because Bibles are done on very thin paper. And in this book, you will find the whole chronology of what happened in France in the years of the occupation, and sad letters from wives saying, could the police please tell me where my husband is? I know he's somewhere. In fact, her husband is dead and get killed in the gas chambers. Say a few words about this book, Serge, the Calendrier.
This book is a chronological history of what happened to Jews in France day by day, how many Jews were arrested, the copy of each document which had an importance on the life and death of Jews, the convoys. It's a reference book. You showed one volume, but today there are two volumes and 3,000 pages. And I didn't write these books for the big, for the great public, but for the happy few. The happy few are the historians. Each historian which wants to write something about the final solution, the Shoah, the Holocaust in France, has the memorial and my memorial, and also Vichy Auschwitz and the calendrier, the calendar of the final solution in France. So that's the legacy of my generation, the generation of the sons and daughters. After our death, it will be impossible for other people to do what we did, find the documents against the resistance of those who didn't want that we could have access to these documents. And to be involved, our whole time to be involved in that work of restitution of what happened to the generation of our father, our mothers, and also of our brothers and sisters. And I am a child of the Holocaust. My father was arrested and we were hidden in a closet while the Gestapo were looking for my mother, my sister, and myself. We escaped, and one day I understood that I did not escape for nothing, and not to live like anybody. Jews cannot live like other people. It's quite impossible, and recent events shows us that that evidence. So I decided with Beate, who wanted to rehabilitate our country, we decided together that we will work. All our life in order to leave something important concerning mostly France.
Beate, you unlike Serge, you had no such background historically. You only when you met Serge did you begin to learn the history of your own country in the Nazi period. What was that like for you? You had to learn a lot, and you did, but it was so different from Serge's point of view. How was it for you to engage with Serge as a German?
Well, you know, when Serge told me his story of his family, you know, in Germany, you know, I left Germany, Berlin, in 1960. So when I was in school, there was nothing told about the Holocaust. The Germans generally had no feeling that they had started the Second World War and responsible for the 6 million Jews. So there was nothing said about. So when I came to Paris, I did nothing about. So Serge told me first his story of his family. And I was very much impressed, you know. And also Serge had some friends who said, you know, you are going with a German girl. And so Serge said, you know, Beate, you are not guilty, but you have to find to, as a German and a good German, to have your responsibility to a few, as assume. And so there was the work I made, due to this, I made later, not to allow that Nazi criminal for the Nazi propagandist as Kurt Georg Kiesinger could become the German chancellor, then also to try to follow and to chase the Nazi criminals. As we meet with the Lischka process, Hagen in Cologne, we chased Walter Rauf, you know, in Chile, Brunner, Barbie, and also as a German responsible for the, you know, my country was responsible for the death of the million of Jews. So I said, as a German, I will not go when I see a Jew and say, oh, I regret, but I will say, I will do something in order to repair. And the repair was to always to protest when a country was anti-Semitism, as in Warsaw or in Prague, to be on the summit of meetings in Arab countries, and to support the state of Israel. You know, I had been very often in Israel. I was proposed by the Knesset for the Nobel Peace Prize. I have the citizenship today, you know. They also had done things in order to shake hands. And when I came, I remember to Menachem Begin, when I saw he was not prime minister, I saw him in his private home and he said, oh, Beate, you know, it's wonderful what you are doing. I'd like to shake hands with you. So I was recompensed for this, what I have done. And I'm still proud today that as I could do something. And I was, yes, you know, the trip we will do in solidarity with Israel. So I will continue now to do something.
Well, I should tell the audience, I have traveled with Beate to Damascus, where she came in disguise because she had already been thrown out. I remember waiting for her flight to debark and everybody came off the plane and I thought, oh, Beate isn't on this plane. And then someone came very close to my face and I looked and there with a wig on her head and special makeup, and a not very fashionable coat, it was Beate. And a few days later, we went to the interior ministry of the Syrian government, and Beate walked across the street toward the gates where there were various policemen all guarding it. And suddenly, out of her coat, she pulled out a big sign saying, What did that sign say? Release, send Brunner back to France. They grabbed her, the police grabbed her, they threw her in a car. What I remember is, as she crossed the street, she looked like Joan of Arc. She wasn't afraid. She knew she was going to be arrested. For sure she was going to be arrested. But she was proud, you know, this is the moment I've come for. Unfortunately, the man died in his bed, which none of us wanted to have happen. But you made the great effort. And the same in Chile, where, where's my brains? Who was in Chile, the criminal there? Walter Rauch. And one night we went at midnight to his house and threw a stone through his window, and wrapped around the stone, it said, "You will not die in your own bed, Walter Rauch." That was a great moment for me. And Beata was always fearless. She did what she knew what it was important for her to do. It was remarkable. I'm going to jump quickly here because I know time is passing the saddest of all the books. And this is just volume one. This is called French Children of the Holocaust. And on the cover here, you see a young lady named Annie Yolande Horowitz, born 1933. At this point, she was 7 years old. You see in big red letters, Juif. You turn the book the other way, and you see Leopold Jakovich, a young boy. Both these children were arrested in Indre-et-Loire, that province, and both were killed at Auschwitz. In this book are photos of thousands of children who were deported from France. I don't even know what I'm looking at, but you can see. Of all the books the Klarsfelds have done, this is possibly the most heartrending. It just tears your heart to see these photos. And I think as I look at them, I hope to see, maybe this child survived, but in almost none of them survived. So, speak a little about how you were able to assemble the photos of these children who were deported to Auschwitz.
When we succeeded to obtain the arrest of Klaus Barbie, and Beate made two campaigns in Bolivia in 1972, control the situation of Barbie, and eventually we succeeded to get Barbie back to France and to be on trial in Lyon in 1987 and sentenced to life perpetuity. So I could find the photos of the 44 children who were deported by...
I'm going to show this cover, yes, of this book.
Children of Dieu, yeah. Human. And I could find the photo of the 44 children by tracing the families and finding the photo in France, in Germany, in Poland, in Israel, in Australia, in Brazil. I could find them. So I decided to find the photo of all the children who were deported from France. And until now, we could discover, with the help of the Sons of Daughters, I asked our group to make advertisements in Jewish press in many countries. And we could find 5,500 photos of the 11,000 children who were deported from France. We published two volumes, like the volume you showed, which was volume number one. We published the second volume, and we will publish perhaps a third volume with all, again, many photos. We don't want the children to disappear.
And we have also shown an exhibition, the Jewish children deported from France, and we put these exhibitions, you know where? In the railway stations in France, in the big railway, in the reception room. So the people came in order to take a train, and they saw these photos. And under the photos was said, deported without mother, without father. And it was also shown in the United States, this exhibition in English, and also in Germany. I succeeded. It was not easy to put this in the railway stations, the exhibition about German and Austrian Jewish children deported from France. So, you know, we put it directly to the people, you know, and they were surprised to see it in order to go somewhere for holidays or to see these pictures. And they looked on it and they were very much impressed because the text showing what happened to these children was very impressive for them.
I'll go to something quite dramatic, which is Kurt Lischka, who was the head of the Paris Gestapo, a major Nazi figure. The Klarsfelds located him very easily in Germany because Beata called information and asked, is there a Kurt Lischka in the Cologne phone book? And they said yes, and gave the address and the phone number.
Lischka, comment a trouvé Lischka?
At the time, Nazi criminals who operated in France were sure not to be punished because they could not be extradited to France and they couldn't be judged in Germany. So they were very quiet. They took again their names, and to find the head of the Gestapo in France, Kurt Lischka, we had only to ask at that time the information bureau of the telephone book. And I asked, do you have Kurt Lischka in Cologne, because we knew that before to come to Paris, Kurt Lischka was head of the Gestapo of Cologne, and the reply of the bureau was, yes, he is living 554 Bergisch Gladbacher Straße in Cologne. And so you know that to find a Nazi criminal at that time was sometimes not very difficult for people like Mengele or Eichmann. It was perhaps more difficult, or for Barbie. But we found also Barbie, who was not living in Cologne or in Munich, but living in Bolivia at 4,000 meters upon the sea, and we found him, we discovered him, and not his name, but a false name also. So we were able to find Nazi criminals living quietly in Germany or living abroad under false names.
Wow. So thank you, Peter, and thank you, Serge and Beata, for this important interview. So right now, I'm going to turn the floor to my colleague, Mariana Abrantes, who has a very important presentation to make. Mariana, please.
Hello. Good evening from Portugal. I'm Mariana Abrantes. I am a member of the board of the Sousa Mendes Foundation, based in Portugal, very near the house where the future Sousa Mendes Museum will be created. As you know, Aristides de Sousa Mendes was an early hero. He was recognized as a righteous among the nations in 1966 for his extraordinary action of rescue in 1940, when the Nazi forces invaded France and reached Paris in a week. Millions of people sought to flee south and crowded into Bordeaux. Spain was closed after the Civil War, and so a visa to a third country was essential to get out of France, to evade deportation later. And Portugal was the country. And Aristides faced a great dilemma, of course, because Salazar, the dictator in Portugal, had expressly forbidden the diplomats to provide visas to a number of different classes of people, including Jews, gypsies, communists, etc. And he could simply follow those instructions, or he could follow the dictates of his own conscience and issue visas to Portugal to save all those people whose anguish he found indescribable. The people crowded in Bordeaux, Place des Cantons, etc. So he made the humanitarian choice, and that's why we're all here today. I'm amazed that we are hearing from Mr. and Mrs. Klarsfeld about the people who were deported. We, the Sousa Mendes Foundation, are very grateful for the people that were saved in France. So it's a much smaller number, perhaps, than the 76,000 that you found, unfortunately. But I'm very pleased to meet you online. I'm very impressed with this extraordinary action. And so here I have a special certificate to Serge and the Beate Klarsfeld today, the 3rd of December of 2023. This was the Mendes Foundation Humanitarian Award. And I call your attention to the phrase at the bottom, which says, which we quote Aristides Sousa Mendes from his own defense. He said, when asked why did he did it, he said, I could not have acted otherwise. I just mentioned as well that besides the colors of the Portuguese, of the Sousa Mendes Foundation, the certificate has the colors of the Portuguese flag. And this certificate comes with another little piece, which is a very nice box. And it is inside, if you'll show the insides of the box. It contains a lovely case made of Portuguese cork and acrylic. And inside that lovely case is a silver coin, which was issued by the Portuguese National Mint on the occasion of the 80th anniversary of Aristides' momentous decision to try to save them all. And we see the image on the face of Aristides showing calm determination and the statement in Portuguese, righteous among the nations, and 1885 to 1954, his dates. And on the back, we see the value of €5, but don't use it for coffee. It'll be very expensive coffee, because this one is a collector's item. And we see also the oldest Portuguese symbol on the right-hand side, which are the seven castles, which created Portugal over 1,000 years ago. And we see the five values that Aristides defended by his dramatic rescue action: humanity, equality, dignity, hope, esperança, or tikva, as I have learned, and liberty, freedom. So thank you very much, Mr. and Mrs. Klarsfeld, for your extraordinary action. And I hope you will be able to come to Portugal sometime.
Thank you.
We are proud to receive that award. Thank you very much. Because we know, of course, the action of Aristides de Sousa Mendes and And we know that he was, Portugal was not grateful
yes.
to him during the Salazar period.
Yes, yes, yes. But we are very grateful today, and we are making sure that his actions are remembered, because that we need people like him and like yourselves to bring justice and to bring truth and clarity to show that we don't have to give in to
but
evil.
But he's known all over the world as some diplomats, Japanese diplomat, Estonian diplomat,
right.
Italian diplomats, and who saved Jews in the international diplomacy. There were some diplomats who, during that period, helped Jews, and of course, the Jewish international community tries not to forget these diplomats, and there are many exhibitions all over the world about them.
Thank you.
Great. So we will be sending you this award and certificate to your home. Now let's get to audience questions. So, Beata, here's a question for you. As a German, when you went up and you slapped Kissinger, you said Nazi, and you slapped him, the slap heard around the world. When you did that, did you know the story of Hans and Sophie Scholl and the White Rose? Were you familiar at that time? Did they inspire you?
Oh, yes. I remember I told you before that when I met Serge, and some of his friends said, why are you going with the German? And Serge told, you know, you have an example for you, Hans and Sophie Scholl. They fought, you know, and they were killed and decapitated by the axe. So this was for me, and also, you know, something very important. Hans and Sophie Scholl, you have in Germany now a lot of schools and streets called after their name. It was not immediately after that, but now, you know, it's there an example for I think mainly also for the young generations, though, because they had known that they're sending the flyers in the universities that they will be arrested, not killed, perhaps. But they took this on them, and with the professors, you know, they were together killed. And I think that's very important to see that young people, there had not been a big group up behind them, but they said, we have to do something. And I think that's the most important also for the young people today to see how you can be engaged and to do it if you feel it is necessary. And it was necessary, you know.
So today we're living again in a very dangerous time with the war in Israel, the rise of anti-Semitism, and all the success of the far right throughout Europe and Latin America. What can we do today as individuals to fight against this terrible situation that we're in?
It's difficult. Anti-Semitism is a quite of malady, illness,
disease
of humanity. And so Jews have, I always told to young Jews that they will have to live with their life will be always with anti-Semitism. They cannot avoid that. Why it is difficult to understand, perhaps because I believe Jews have invented, the Jewish people has invented the moral law, and it's not... it's people don't want to forgive the Jewish people for having invented the difference between the good and the bad, the evil and the And so Jews are only 15 million people. And in the world, you have 7 billion people. Many of these 7 billion people suffer from many pressures. They are poor, they are under political regimes which are oppressive. And so they try to think, to find who is responsible, and they don't understand that the Jewish people with only 15 million people can in many countries be at higher positions because they are the people of the book. They study. It's always their ambition is to study and to succeed in their and in their endeavors. So I don't know the book emissaire. I don't know, but many people in the world put the responsibility of their suffering on the Jewish people because they believe that the Jewish people is the leader of the world, which is not at all the case. And the Jewish people during 19th century had no state, no Jewish state. And since 80 years, they have a Jewish state. And so that Jewish state becomes a scapegoat. And you cannot destroy now the Jewish people because the Jewish people is gathered in the Western countries, which are mostly democratic countries. But the Jewish state can be destroyed. And the anti-Semitism of today is to be against the Jewish people. And the Jewish people as against the Jewish state as against him, the Arab Muslim world, but not only after these recent crimes committed by Hamas, all the countries, all the population of poor countries all around the world suddenly expressed their hate against that small Jewish state, which is and they do not protest for other crimes committed in some countries. But against the Jewish state, there is a world hate and the destruction of, and you have also in the Western countries, the university population, a part of that population is also against Jews and against the support of Jews, the support of the Jewish state by Jews everywhere in the world. And of course, it's Jews are very anxious today, and like they were in the 30s, in the 20th century, they are very anxious and And we will see what will happen. In 1935, we couldn't expect what will happen. And today, when Iran threats Israel to when they will have a nuclear bomb to send the nuclear bomb on Israel, so we have to take seriously into account that threat, because in 1935, the threats of Hitler were not taken into account by the Jewish international community. So now we have to, Jews have to be strong, and they have to be united, mostly united, to because they will have to fight for their survival.
So now I'll turn the floor over to Shulamit Reinhartz, my colleague from Brandeis University. Shulamit.
Hello, everyone. My name is Shulamit Reinhartz, and I'm a retired professor from Brandeis University. You may have seen me on about a dozen different film discussions over the past recent years as a speaker or as a moderator. Today, I'd like to ask you to join me in supporting the Sousa Mendes Foundation. I presume all of you who watched the Klarsfeld film recognize the many ways that this film should be important to us. I'm referring especially to Beate and Serge Klarsfelds, who have passed on the torch, as Serge was just speaking about making the connection between the Nazi period, frankly, and today. We have to recognize fascist regimes. We probably have to slap somebody over the face, in the face. We have to recognize anti-Semitic political parties, which is a big point of the film, which I appreciated. And we have to support other parties that do not promote hatred and racism. In other words, we have to use politics and dramatic action. I have become, since my first conversation ever with Olivia, I have become a cheerleader for the Sousa Mendes Foundation. The more I learn about it, the more I cheer. Last year and this year, I met two young non-Jewish men, one who is on your screen, Louis Leibel. They are from Austria, and they are spending their year as Sousa Mendes Foundation interns. That in itself is a good bridge. This past summer, I traveled by bus with Olivia and about 30 other people from Bordeaux, France, to Lisbon, Portugal. We traced the steps of the people whom Aristides de Sousa Mendes saved. We went on the same journey as they did. Because of the research that Olivia did before the trip, she discovered several participants who, or several people whose parents were a part of the group that Sousa Mendes saved, but the grandchildren or the children didn't know it. They did not know what their parents went through, but Olivia did, and she called them up and told them. And that for the first time, these people who are now in their 70s, maybe 80s, discovered that they were Jewish. And they came on the trip to see what this meant to them and gave their testimony. They brought their whole families with them. Marianne was one of the people who led us on that trip. I have been in Jerusalem and seen with my own eyes the plaque that is behind Olivia, telling the Israeli people who pass by that plaza that who Sousa de Mendes is and why was he a great man. out of my admiration for the work that Olivia Mattis has done and has been doing, teaching people about resilience and resistance through these programs, my husband and I have become donors. This is one form of resistance, resistance against forgetting. I hope you will continue to watch our regular film and panel discussions and that you will support the work of the Sousa Mendes Foundation. This is the time of giving. This is the time to give as resistance. The foundation is small enough that you can get to know everyone who is involved, but it's large enough to have an enormous impact. Danke schön, merci beaucoup, toda rabba, and thank you.
Au revoir.
Au revoir.
Wonderful. So right now we're going to see a little film about what we have upcoming here at the Sousa Mendes Foundation. Just a little clip to entice you all to get season tickets and to join us for next year. So let's see that clip.
Quand on a que l'amour pour habiller matin, pauvres et malandrins de manteau de velours. Quand on n'a que l'amour à offrir en prière pour les maux de la terre en simple troubadour. Quand on n'a que l'amour à offrir à ceux-là dont l'unique combat est de chercher le jour. Quand on n'a que l'amour pour tracer un chemin et forcer le destin à chaque carrefour. Quand on n'a que l'amour pour parler au canon et rien qu'une chanson pour convaincre.
Everyone, thank you to our fabulous speakers. Thank you to our sponsor who was able to make it possible for many of you to have free sponsored tickets. We would love for you to all become season ticket members, and so you'll get that information in the email to come. Happy Hanukkah, Merry Christmas, Happy New Year. See you all in 2024. Love you all. Bye bye, everybody. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.